We're going to go over modernism today in our chapter titled Modernism, the Assault on Tradition from 1890 to 1950. We're going to look at the development of film. We're going to see the further developments of modern art that started in our last chapter with realism and impressionism and post-impressionism. And we're going to start to move really quickly through these styles. We're going to look at modern poetry. We're going to see what Ezra Pound brings to poetry. We're going to look at some modern literature, including Kafka. And I'm going to show you some early films, a couple short clips that hopefully won't get censored here. And then we're going to end with the development of music. And we are going to see the development of blues, ragtime, and jazz, and also some modern dance as well. The chapter is pretty lengthy. There's a lot to go over, and I want to try to do this without allowing the video to go too long. Like, I don't want to go over 2 hours, but let's see how this goes. So we have a painting by Vasily Kandinsky, who was a lawyer, and he saw a painting of horses and riders on its side, and the subject matter was gone when he saw that painting on its side. And so he began to kind of liberate painting from subject matter and narrative and paint it in a way that he thought was spiritually liberating. Painting like music is what he was trying to do. So in the modern era, in the early 20th century, no age has broken with tradition more radically or more self-consciously than the 20th century, which in the opening decades produced the movements that became modernism. Modernism willfully rejects conventional values in favor of experimentation and innovation, and at its most extreme, anarchy and nihilism, a view that all values are baseless. The modernist revolution was fed by dramatic advances in science and technology, by the impact of two devastating world wars, and the atrocities of totalitarian regimes. As the fabric of traditional moral and religious values unravel in the West, older styles like neoclassicism, romanticism, and realism give way to the complexities of cubism, expressionism, surrealism, and non-objective art, abstraction, which we're looking at here, which is the reduction of recognizable form to its essence, color, shape, form, line. This becomes a hallmark of modernism in the visual arts. In literature, ambiguity, absurdity, and forays into the working of the unconscious mind challenge the descriptive narrative from people like James Joyce and Kafka. Modern composers are abandoning conventional melody and harmony, and both music and dance is creating exotic and erotic and unprecedented candor in its art. And the unbridled will to make it new, as Ezra Pound and others are saying, that is really the heart of modernism. Let's see something different. Let's see something new. Now, in terms of changes in the 20th century in physics. So in physics, Isaac Newton had advanced the model of the universe. He believed that the universe operated under smooth functioning mechanical laws that spoke generally to a sense of the world of perception. Modern physicists propose, however, that at its physical extremities of nature, in the microcosmic realm of atomic particles, Newton's law simply did not apply. So this is developed in the 1880s when the universal, the speed of light is considered to be a universal constant. In 1900, German physicist Max Planck theorized that light waves behave as separate, discontinuous bundles of energy. German physicist Albert Einstein made his special theory of relativity public in 1905. This was a radically new approach to the concepts of time, space, and motion. While Newton had held that the object preserved the same properties rather at rest or in motion, Einstein theorized that as an object approached light speed, its mass increased and its motion slowed. Time and space, argued Einstein, were not separate coordinates, but rather complementary and interrelated entities. Pushing Einstein's theories further, Werner Heisenberg observed, since the very act of measuring subatomic phenomena altered them, the position and the velocity of subatomic particles could not be measured simultaneously with absolute accuracy. This is Heisenberg's principle of uncertainty from 1927. The more precisely the position of the particle is determined, the less precisely its momentum can be known. And this replaces the absolute model of the universe with one based in indeterminacy. Quantum physics gives mankind greater insight into the workings of the universe, but also makes the operation of the universe more remote for the average person's understanding. It becomes inaccessible to both the human eye and the camera and lies in the realm of the senses. So we are no longer purely at the empirical method in science that we had been learning about from the Enlightenment, also from Aristotle. That is now new territory. Also, we get new technology in jet propulsion, radar technology, computer electronics, but also, maybe more importantly, atomic fission, the splitting of the atom that begins after 1920. And this confirms the validity of Einstein's formula E equals MC2, which describes mass and energy as different manifestations of the same thing. A very small amount of mass or matter can be converted into a very large amount of energy. The Freudian Revolution. So Sigmund Freud is challenging the perceptions of the internal world, the human mind. He is pioneering the analysis of dreams and free association, the spontaneous verbalization of thoughts. He founded psychoanalysis, a therapeutic method which represents in which repressed desires are brought to the conscious level and reveal sources of emotional disturbance. Freud is the first to map the human mind. He is seeing the psyche as three parts: the id, the seat of human instincts, the beast within, the source of all physical desires, the ego, which is the manager that functions to adopt the needs of the id to the real world, and the superego, the moral monitor or conscience that operates according to the principles inoculated by parents, teachers, and social authority. To Freud, instinctual id drives, in particular the libido or the sex drive, govern human behavior. The guilt from repression of instinctual urge dominates the unconscious life of human beings. In Freud's view, civilization is the product of the ego's will, of the ego's effort to direct the primal urges of the id. In his book, Civilization and Its Discontents, he believes that by living in a society and living under law, that we are all making compromises and are disconnected, are discontented by it. In his interpretation of dreams, He is deciphering the unconscious through dreams, and he examines the function of the unconscious is in the evolution of religion and morality. So he is presenting this kind of new radical model of human behavior. Copernicus had dislodged us from being the central place in the cosmos. Darwin had deposed Homo sapiens as unique amongst Earth creatures. And now Freud is revealing the dark undersoul of humankind, refuting the precept that human reason governs human behavior. Carl Jung is also interested in an unconscious life that rests in deeper and more universal layers of the human mind that he calls the collective unconscious. In this realm, he believes that humankind at large manifests itself through a history in the form of dreams and myths and fairy tales, the archetypes, primal patterns of the realm that reflect the deep psychic needs of humankind, as does religion. Wars and revolution. So the Great War of 1914, World War I, is the first of two total wars. Total wars because they involve more nations that had ever been engaged in armed combat, and also because they killed, along with military personnel, millions of civilian. Total war is no holds barred war. 1914's war originated in military imperialism, the effort of European nation states to extend their dominion of Europe and to have military expansion into their colonial holdings. In 1914, Austria-Hungary, seeking to expand Austria-Hungarian territory to the south, used the political assassination of Archduke Ferdinand, the heir to the throne of Austria-Hungary, as a pretext to declare war on Serbia. Almost immediately, two opposing alliances were locked in confrontation: the Central Powers of Austria-Hungary and Germany, and the Ottoman Empire, versus the Allied forces of Serbia, Belgium, France, Great Britain, Russia, and eventually the United States. In the beginning of the war, the Central Powers win victory in Belgium and in Poland, but they stop the German advance in September 1914. The two armies settle down into warfare on the Western Front, a solid line of opposing trenches that stretches 500 miles from the English Channel to the Swiss border. On the Eastern Front, Russia lost over a million soldiers in combat, facing the forces of Austria-Hungary and Germany. And ultimately, the United States will stay neutral until 1917. German submarines began sinking unarmed passenger ships, which led the American president Woodrow Wilson to support the Allies. The weapons and advanced technology in World War I made war more impersonal, more devastating. Combatants used machine guns, grenades, artillery, poison gas, flamethrowers, armored tanks, submarines, and airships, and eventually airplanes. So a rapid-fire automatic machine gun alone, all by itself, caused almost 80% of the casualties as they would charge into the no-man's lands between the trenches. The death toll in all is around 70 million armed men, and more than 8 million of them are going to die. In the aftermath, here we're seeing a painting about the artist John Singer Sargent, who is showing us what the poison gas in the aftermath looked like. So mustard gas was a gas that when it would explode, it would liquefy a person's lungs. And if it didn't kill you, it would cause blindness, of course, breathing problems for the rest of your life. And this weapon was so terrible that they got together and they agreed that they would still keep fighting each other in the future, but they wouldn't use mustard gas. So this total war actually began to have a limit to it. In the aftermath of the war, the United States is emerging from the war as a great creditor nation, but its economy is tied to world conditions. Following the crash of the stock market in 1929, there will be a Great Depression. The war also caused a lot of the generation that fought the war is called the Lost Generation. All of the people who were killed, as well as I think all the psyches that were destroyed, which we're seeing here from Ernst Kirchner, a German expressionist artist, and his self-portrait as a soldier, and his perhaps Freudian fear, unconscious fear of losing a hand and never being able to make art again. We see coming out of this war, literature about the war, like All Quiet on the Western Front, who was a German veteran of the war. The book describes the soldiers' extreme physical and mental stress during the war and the detachment from civilian life felt by many of these soldiers when they returned from the war. In the Great Depression, from the stock market crash, we have millions of people out of work. We have an America on the brink of falling apart. And here we're looking at a photo by Margaret Bourke White from 1937, titled At the Time of the Louisville Flood, where there are people, black people, waiting in line for help from the government. And ironically, a billboard behind them is a white couple all smiling and laughing with their dog in the car, talking about the world's highest standard of living. And then the sub headline is saying, there's no way like the American way. And I think that irony between people who were able to survive the Depression without too much trouble versus the many Americans who really had to struggle, to the point that ultimately we got a safety net in the 30s that included things like unemployment insurance and things that would help us out ultimately when things got bad through the government. Photographer Dorothea Lange is photographing what happens in the Great Depression in the Dust Bowl when farms overfarm the land in the Midwest. The FSA, the Farm Security Administration, that had also been developed in the 30s, sent Dorothea out to photograph the migrant workers who had migrated from places like Oklahoma into California. And we see this mother here with two children whose head is turned away, a baby in her lap, looking very pensive. She looks very old for her age, probably wearing handmade clothes that are filthy, living without electricity, living without sanitation, not knowing where the future lies for her. And I think that also kind of captures the very essence of how people were struggling during the Depression. Walker Evans also is a photographer who is going around because of the Farm Security Administration documenting the Great Depression as well. The Harlem Renaissance. So with African Americans, the economic problems of the Depression are even more intense because of racism. And more than 5 million African Americans migrate from the South to the Northern states. There is a fear now of black competition for jobs. Race riots are taking place. And there is a bloody summer in 1919 because of it. Nevertheless, between 1920 and 1940, the part of Manhattan known as Harlem becomes home to many African Americans and becomes a location of an outpouring of creative expression in the arts, black poets, painters, musicians. This is where jazz is really being developed as it comes out of New Orleans. And we are seeing here a collage created by Romare Bearden, talking about jamming at a nightclub called the Savoy. Poet Langston Hughes. Langston Hughes is one of the many literary voices of the Harlem Renaissance, a musician as well as a writer. He is a poet that is writing with very powerful images in his Dream Deferred. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust over and sugar over like syrupy sweet? Or maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode? Very powerful words about the possibility of the frustrations that are being faced and how those frustrations are going to be expressed. In Russia, there is a revolution. Russia enters World War I in 1914 under the leadership of Tsar Nicholas II. The Russians lose over 1 million men, 1 million more desert. There are food shortages, fuel shortages. Strikes and riots break out in 1917, and the October Revolution of 1917 forces the Tsar to abdicate. The Socialist Democratic Labor Party takes over, and Marxist revolutionary Vladimir Lenin will become the premier of the Marxist Socialists, the Bolsheviks. They are tailoring Marxist ideas to the needs of revolutionary Russia. He becomes the architect of Soviet communism, and he agrees with Marx that a dictatorship of the proletariat is the first step in liberating the workers from bourgeois suppression. While condemning the state as an organ of state of class discrimination, he proposes a transition to a classless society in a series of phases that he outlines in his pamphlet, The State and the Revolution, in 1917. However, the Bolsheviks instead will create a dictatorship rather than giving up power, and they will establish the first totalitarian regime of the 20th century. This is a concept formulated by Italian theorists in the 1920s, that subordinating the life of the individual to the needs of the state through strict control of political, economic, and cultural life, and by means of coercive measures such as censorship and terrorism, will be the best way to rule. Following Lenin is the rule of Joseph Stalin. He takes over the bureaucracy in 1926 and launches vast programs of industrialization, agricultural collectivization, and the transformation of private farms into government-run farms. He also is going to purge through his secret police dissidents, and other people to gulags, or they will be executed. Between 28 and 38, the combination of severe famine and Stalin's inhumane policies, later known as the Great Terror, take the lives of 15 to 20 million Russians. A art style that is controlled by the state is called socialist realism. So the state is controlling architectural production, and architectural production is serving the state. And you get these kind of very strange kind of posters and paintings, like Stalin holding a baby who is holding the communist flag and a bouquet of flowers. So Stalin is becoming a literal patriarch, the father of everybody, and like a stern father, making tough decisions. We have a revolution in Mexico between 1910 and 1920. The utopian ideas of Vladimir Lenin are spreading in the spirit in Latin America and in Mexico. In Mexico, 95% of the population was landless, and they are trying to broaden the base of land ownership through a revolution that lasted from 1911 to 1912. The Mexican Revolution was first a social revolt that united the masses of peasants and urban workers, and ultimately will lead to a several-year conflict that will lead to a constitutional government. Adolf Hitler will come to power through the loss of Germany in World War I and the instability politically and the depression that happens. He will then take power with the Nazi Party, triggering a war in Poland in 1939 that will escalate into World War II. In World War II, there will be a total war that is fought in America on two fronts, with the Japanese, who have sided in their militantism and their expansion into China and to Southeast Asia by attacking Hawaii. America will join the war in 1941 and also fight the Germans. This total war again will ultimately lead to new weapons. And we will find at the end of the war things that we had been hearing about, like the Jewish Holocaust, where in the Jewish Holocaust, the Nazis were going about and not only expanding territory, but they were systematically exterminating Jews, killing approximately 6 million in concentration camps and putting others into ghettos that weren't able to flee. The end of the war first ends in Germany with the end of the Nazis and the end of Hitler, and then America focuses on Japan, and they begin to attack the Japanese mainland after fighting them on islands, liberating the Philippines, Wake Island, and other places, and then will attack Japanese cities, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, with two nuclear bombs in 1945. Which will kill approximately 120,000 people with one bomb, and really begin to take the world and realizing that our technology, Nietzsche was right, no such thing as progress. Our technology has led us to the point that we can now completely exterminate ourselves off the face of the planet, and we still face that today. In modern literature, rejecting the self-indulgent sentiments of the Romantics and the graphic narratives of the Realists, modern writers are seeking a language to express the conceptual and the abstract. One of the early groups is called the Imagists. The Imagists consider a writer to be like a sculptor whose technique required that they carve away all the unnecessary matter, a process of abstraction that arrives at intrinsic or essential forms. Unconfined by traditional verse forms and fixed meter, free verse style becomes famous for its abrupt and discontinuous juxtaposition of images. The most influential poet of the Imagists is Ezra Pound. Pound is a student of Asian calligraphy, drawing inspiration from Chinese and Japanese verse, and especially the haiku, which employs a close succession of images to evoke a subtle metaphoric relationship in very few syllables. So many of Pound's poems have historical references, foreign language phrases, obscene jokes. He is begging, exhorting his colleagues and people around the world, art makers, to make it new. Make it new. In modern poetry, from T.S. Eliot, who is educated at Harvard University and studies at Oxford when World War I breaks out. He becomes a British citizen in 1927. The Wasteland in 1922 draws on Eastern and Western myths of death and rebirth to suggest the aridity of modern life and the eternal quest for redemption. Stripped of romantic sentiment, the densely packed and startling, often obscure images and invented rhythms of the wasteland quickly become a landmark of modern poetry. The modern verse is compressed, complex, cryptic, and serious. In his post-war despair and illusionment and disillusion, he is also writing a poem called The Rock. And in The Rock, he talks about that in the cycles of heaven in 20 centuries, bringing us further from God and nearer to dust. There are other poets like W.B. Yeats and Robert Frost also, again, imploring us to make it new. Yeats is talking about a second coming, the second coming shaped with a lion's body and the head of man, a gaze blank, pitless as the sun. Modern fiction and drama. Marcel Proust is writing a literary fiction as psychology in space and time. In Search of Lost Time, translated as Remembrance of Things Past, we have seven parts written between 1913 and 1927. It's a lengthy portrait of turn-of-the-century Parisian society and regarded as the first European novel to feature homosexuality in the lives of its characters. Its central theme is the role of memory in retrieving past experience and in shaping one's private life. In the first volume of the novel, he employs the Freudian technique of free association to recapture from the recesses of memory the intense moment of pleasure occasioned on the taste of a piece of cake soaked in tea. That cake soaked in tea brings back these memories, incites these memories, enlivens the imagination in the person while they're having these memories. And again, engaging in the unconscious. Franz Kafka is writing novels and short stories that take on the reality of dreams in which characters are nameless, details are precise but grotesque. In The Metamorphosis and in The Trial, 1925, the protagonist, Joseph K., is arrested, convicted, and executed without ever knowing the nature of his crime. In The Metamorphosis in 1915, Gregor Samsa wakes up one morning to discover that he has been turned into a large insect. The themes of insecurity and vulnerability dominate the prose of Kafka. In James Joyce, James Joyce is deeply indebted to Freud. His publications include Ulysses, where he makes use of the interior monologue, the private musings of a character. Inspired by the free association ideas of Freud used in psychotherapy, he writes, really challenging the reader to kind of follow with this basis of writing, a new idea called the stream of consciousness, a succession of thoughts and images connected not by any sort of logical argument or narrative sequence, but by the free play of psyche. In Ulysses, modeled after Homer's Odyssey, he records the adventures of his protagonist, Leopold Bloom, who he moves through the streets of Dublin in a single day. And again, that single day being the kind of play that you might read in Aristotle's, or be described in Aristotle's Poetic, where all the action takes place in one day. Again, using Ulysses is kind of interesting in that relationship. The real action of the novel takes place in the mind of Leopold. Joyce's modern character is as ordinary as, say, Homer's Ulysses was heroic. His adventures seem trivial and insignificant, but his ruminations memorably capture the overwhelming sense of desolation that marked the first decades of the 20th century. Virginia Woolf is an English writer considered a major innovator in the English language. In her work, she experiments also with a stream of consciousness and the underlying psychological as well as emotional motives of her characters. Her novels are experimental. A narrative frequently uneventful and commonplace is refracted, almost dissolved, in the character's receptive consciousness. Elie Wiesel is writing about his experiences in Auschwitz, showing us how completely barbaric the entire place was, and how not only are the Nazis cruel, but also fellow prisoners in just trying to stay alive also commit cruelty upon each other. He loses any faith in God, and any belief that there can be any sort of real covenant between God and the Jews, and tries to figure out how to go on after Auschwitz. Science fiction. So French novelist Jules Verne is stirring up the imagination before the turn of the century. H.G. Wells is writing The War of the Worlds in 1898, an apocalyptic tale of an invasion of the planet Earth. Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, a landmark novel written in 1932, pictures a society in which modern technology and the techniques of human engineering operate to destroy our freedom. In Huxley's futuristic society, babies are conceived in test tubes, following assembly line methods initiated by Henry Ford and for the manufacturing of cars. Individuals are conditioned to perform socially beneficial tasks, families are eradicated, and society is purged of art and religion, and human anxieties are suppressed by means of mood-altering drugs. In modern art again is about make it new. We are stripping down the picture plane. We are re-envisioning the physical world with new formal languages that evoke rather than describe experience, just like the imagist poetries. Pablo Picasso, a Spanish painter who goes to Paris, is influenced by Impressionism and Post-Impressionism. And then he is influenced by the paintings of Cézanne and images like Mont Saint-Victoire that we studied in our last lecture. He recognizes a new rigorous language of forms based on underlying structure. He is influenced by African and Oceanic sculpture, and he creates a new way of making pictures in Europe with his massive Damoiselles of D'Avignon. Five nude women, prostitutes in a Spanish bordello, occupy a shallow space that is really similar to what we saw in El Greco in the Baroque chapter, where there is no separation between background and foreground now. It is completely similar, completely flat. There are fractured planes of color. We find shards of broken, or things that appear to be like shards of broken glass in terms of the facets, the way that the people are made. There are multiple viewpoints as if we're watching a film. And on the far right, we are seeing the faces turning into something that looks like perhaps a African mask. He has shifted us from the Renaissance that cared about anatomy and perspective and clear space under planes, rectangular facets, and no sense of space anymore. Cubism becomes a new formal language that will become very popular very quickly, and also art will move on to other things too. Also, we will see Picasso innovating the collage, where he is taking newspapers, he is taking other elements like wallpaper and his own drawings, pasting them together to make something new. Here we are seeing in the newspaper in which Le Jeu, the game, appears just above the title of an article that says the battle has begun. And this phrase has been interpreted alluding to the Balkan Wars, but also the beginning of the challenge of collage as a new pictorial form itself with this guitar. He also will go on with a new idea in sculpture, the assemblage invented by Picasso, where rather than sculpting, rather than casting, he will begin to find various objects and put them together, once again making another guitar. His paintings will take on very powerful political aspects in Guernica in 1937, a 25-foot long painting that is 11 feet tall, done in grayscale, that using his cubist forms will capture the brutality and suffering of the wartime era here, as we see from the bombing of civilians. We are seeing people burned alive. We are seeing a triangular form of a horse dying and the knight dying with a broken sword, a mother screaming with a dead baby, and a light bulb, an eye that perhaps is us watching the whole sad affair happening. The Futurists. So, futurism was linking technology and art, along with the Making It New mandate coming from F.T. Marinetti. He is attacking all forms of academic culture and is interested in an art of burning violence. He declares that there can be no modern painting except from the starting point of the absolute modern sensation, the roaring motor car, more beautiful than any Greek sculpture. They are engaging in collages, they are engaging in abstraction, and Umberto Bossioni, his unique forms of continuity in space, we see a kind of cubist painting coming alive in a three-dimensional form of dynamic, jagged lines of a human form that is moving swiftly through space and losing its form. Maybe in the ways that also Einstein is talking about. For me, Matisse and the Fauves, I think, is very important. The Fauves are the wild beasts. They have decided that we do not need to take color and mix it with white, black, browns, or grays to make them look more like the real world. Instead, because of the synthetic manufacturing of paint, we can use the paint out of the tube, which is something that Vincent van Gogh had been doing in post-impressionism. But van Gogh was generally still making the sky blue, grass green, harvesting wheat yellow. But Matisse and the Joy of Life has taken color and made it totally the arbitrary choice of the artist. The sky can be purple, the trees can be rainbow color, people can be green and purple and modulate color. There is a whole new way of painting that, for me as an artist, was really a sign of liberation, that art is now purely subjective, purely the interior id of the artist can come out in painting. Non-objective art from Kazimir Malevich, Piet Mondrian, Kandinsky, which we saw in our first slide. Malevich is creating a movement called suprematism, the supremacy of pure artistic feeling, and is getting rid of their narration. And one of his most famous paintings is The Black Square. From Mondrian, He has taken a, he was a very good landscape painter that became interested in cubism, and his trees gradually abstract themselves into the style where there is only horizontal and vertical lines. They are asymmetric, much in the same vein that Degas' ballerinas were in Impressionism. And we see only the colors yellow, red, and blue, the modern colors, the primary colors on the color wheel, and then black and white, and a variation that can come from this that is very machine-like. In Expressionism, Edvard Munch is the first Expressionist artist. He is a Norwegian painter obsessed with the traumas of puberty, sexuality. He is troubled with personal associations with death. And the Scream in 1908 is trying to capture the mental collapse that he is going through. We see a mood of urgency and alarm, the combined effects of sinuous clouds, withering, writhing black and blue waters, a dramatically receding pier, and suddenly the sky turns red as blood. His friends walk on, according to Munch, and I was left alone, trembling with fear. I felt if all nature was filled with one mighty unending shriek. From the expressionists in Germany that continue this idea that art should be about an interior feeling, not how art looks, we have the first kind of major group, Die Brücke, or the bridge, talking about the conscious to the unconscious bridge, influenced by Freud, the arts of Africa and Oceania, and Ernst Ludwig Kirchner, who we saw as his fear coming back from war without a hand. He's using harsh colors, angular forms, creating canvas filled with pathos and despair. And we are seeing people turning green. We are looking at a Dresden street like bubblegum. And much like Gothic art that we had looked at before the Renaissance, no more anatomy, simply swirling ghost-like figures. The metaphysical art of Giorgio di Chirico is making art beyond physical reality, using sharply delineated images, contradictory perspective, unnatural colors, illogically cast shadows. We are seeing the effect of the dream on art and with these dreamlike images. Out of World War I comes the Dada movement. Absurdity as art, anti-art. This begins with Hugo Ball in the Cabaret Voltaire in 1916, with artists and soldiers who have deserted, who have gone mad, who are just simply pacifists, and they are sitting out the war in Switzerland. And they are performing in a bar of free speech named after Voltaire. Hugo Ball is doing spoken word poetry and speaking gibberish, the kind of gibberish that politicians are speaking that are not ending the war. For Marcel Duchamp, we are getting a new kind of art that the artists need not make anything anymore, simply use art as commentary. So his fountain is a new kind of sculpture where he takes a manufactured urinal, puts it on a pedestal, turns it on its side, carves the name R. Mutt in. Piss on art. Art can be simply something that an artist designates as art rather than making something. That is very influential on art today. In a way, he is creating memes, maybe the first memes, with LHOOQ in his ready-mades. Where we are seeing the cheap postcard of the Mona Lisa defaced with a mustache and a goatee, and a mysterious acronym, LHOOQ, that when spoken in French is a pun that roughly translates into she has a hot ass, or there is a fire down below. Of course, none of these are knowable by looking at the original painting itself, since it is cut off at her midsection. After World War I, the Dada artists and the group is going to break up. They are going to splinter into different places, and surrealism is going to come from the guy on the right here, André Breton, who is someone who visited Freud in Vienna and is describing an art that he would like to see of psychic automatism that is free from rational control, moral inhibitions, and aesthetic restraints. On the left, we're looking at Marin Oppenheim's Luncheon in Fur, which is a metaphor for oral sex. You want to pet it, but you certainly do not want to drink out of the cup filled with all this fur. Salvador Dali, he is creating hand-painted dream photographs. In his Persistence of Memory, shown here, we see a barren landscape with a leafless tree, limp watches, a watch case crawling with ants, and a mass of brain matter resembling Dali's own profile in the middle. From René Magritte, we are getting a betrayal of images. He is addressing a distinction between the real world of actual pipes and the painted image, whose reality is a virtual illusion of a pipe. He makes a painting of a pipe that says this is not a pipe, and you can't put tobacco in it, so it's not a real pipe. In Mexico, we have Frida Kahlo. She is drawing on her native folk cultures to produce a personal style. She is presenting herself in self-portraits as an image of chronic pain that she has gone through after a bus crash. At 18, required 30 surgeries and ultimately the amputation of her right leg. She is creating images of psychological distress, usually around the stormy marriage of her husband, the Mexican muralist Diego Rivera, and also repeated miscarriages. Grief and loss are palpable in her work. Photography and film. So the development of photography in the 1830s will ultimately lead into cutting up photographs and collaging photomontages. And then we will see a new kind of photo used, photos that are influenced by Edward Muybridge. Muybridge begins to take series of photographs in 1878. These images, when placed on a disc called a zoopraxiscope, can be spun and the images appear to move. This device will ultimately become the movie projector invented by Thomas Edison, where they will shoot still photographs on a roll of celluloid at 24 frames per second, and we will see the film coming out of this. Early films, like the Lumiere brothers, were very short films, couple of minutes, even a few seconds. Thomas Edison was showing 20, 30-second films on his Nickelodeons, but ultimately film is going to be broadcast to groups of people in theaters. The beginning of modern film with editing is the Battleship Potemkin from Sergei Eisenstein. This is a revolutionary propaganda film about the takeover in 1905 of a battleship from the Russian Imperial Navy. And when they return home, the soldiers of the Tsar are going to massacre a bunch of civilians. In this film, the Odessa Steps, what we see is a new montage. Now, the films are silent, and an orchestra or a piano player would have accompanied these films until there is sound in film, starting in 1927 with the jazz singer. But here, what we're seeing is not just a single camera like we're watching a theater, but a montage of images. The soldiers, the soldiers like machines where we don't see their faces, the mother confronting the soldiers about the shooting of her dead son, and the kind of intensity that is building from cutting film, collaging the pieces of the shots together, including a moving camera and a dolly shot, and changing the fixed focus as well. Very important scenes here in the Odessa Steppe that are part of the new modern film. In Germany, the montage is being perfected in propaganda films by Leni Riefenstahl's The Triumph of the Will in 1934. That is a film that shows us this great triumph of the Nazis and Adolf Hitler, and using the montage to enhance that reality. In 1927, German Expressionist creates an epic science fiction film from Fritz Lang. This is made in the Weimar period before the Nazis come to power, and we are seeing a future of wealthy industrialists ruling a vast city of metropolis from high-rise tower complexes, while the lower class of underground dwelling workers toil on machines that provide its power. We see robots, and in this short clip that I'm going to show you here, we see the factory workers underground looking exactly like machines as they are toiling away. Flex and gyre. So notice that this is kind of what the futurists, the Italian futurists, the people being more like machines, the people integrated into the machine. The machine is useless without its handler, and the handler is useless without their machine. This is a beginning then of German expressionist film, and also maybe a beginning of us beginning to see that perhaps being like a machine might not be the best thing for all of us. Here again, this amazing shot of the people. You know, the way the people were moving remind me a lot of how a post-punk new wave group called Devo performed, where they moved in this very mechanical way. Look at them doing I Can't Get No Satisfaction on Saturday Night Live in like 1979. It looks a lot like they are performing in Metropolis. Another film of note in this time period by Salvador Dali is the Andalusian Dog, a film of violence and eroticism where we see an eyeball cut by a razor, implying the violence to us as the audience watching the film. In this film, it's made up of close-ups, quick cuts from scene to scene. It's jolting. It has really weird images, like a woman poking a stick at an amputated hand, men pulling a piano with dead donkeys on it. Really, really strange, weird stuff. The architecture and the skyscraper that had been developed by Louis Sullivan, we are now moving into an era of ferroconcrete, material that is steel with concrete reinforcement. We are seeing things like cantilevers, a big area of cement and steel that seems to hang off of a building, and we are getting the international style. So the international style is something that the German school, the Bauhaus, is all about, fusing art and technology. Walter Gropius from the Bauhaus is fusing machine age principles and functional abstract art that we saw, say, from the Suprematists and Piet Mondrian and Kandinsky, who is teaching at the Bauhaus. So in this international style, we are getting a architecture of geometric purity, like a geometric painting by Mondrian, and the materials of ferroconcrete, structural steel, and glass, and we are admiring the steel and the glass. In America, Frank Lloyd Wright is building a modern house with simple geometric shapes. So no more decorations, no more stucco with tendrils and flowers. Pure geometry is the language of modern architecture in the international style. And we are seeing here a cantilever, a large cement reinforced ferroconcrete with steel rods inside that are just hanging over the waterfall, almost miraculously. So the Bauhaus is where these ideas come from, about simple geometric forms that are going to create modern kitchens, modern furniture, modern apartments, modern products are all going to be, your iPhone, our computer, are all extensions of this simple international style, beauty in the materials and geometric shapes. We see this at the Bauhaus when they build their school in Dessau, Germany in 1925. With the geometry, this looks a lot like our community colleges that are built in the mid-century, in the 20th century, out of steel and concrete, and can house a lot of students, have a lot of open spaces, a lot of open window spaces, and are based on geometry. When you look at the dorm here from the Bauhaus, look at how the dorm looks exactly like a Mondrian painting, with the square, the rectangle, the vertical lines, like everything pure geometric and maybe cool and impersonal too, maybe we could say. In music and in dance, we have the Rite of Spring from Igor Stravinsky. So he is making a new kind of music that began with catcalls and hissing, Shortly after the music began, Igor Stravinsky's, the reaction from the audience, they began catcalling and hissing and booing and disrupting the performance because of the sounds, the throbbing rhythms and the dissonant harmonies that are happening and the effects of Nijinsky's eccentric choreography. We saw him in the afternoon with a fawn pretending to be a deer in our last lecture. So this new kind of ballet, which is using the make it new and using a lack of harmony to audiences, they really, really hated it. And the first night causes a riot or near riot, according to newspaper accounts. From Arnold Schoenberg, we are getting French satire, incorporating doorbells and typewriters and roulette wheels. We are getting the first atona, a 12 note of chromatic scales that are equal without a tonal center. And this serialism technique is called the 12 tone system. So it might be inverted or played backwards or played down. And we see this in Pierrot in the Moonlight, and also Pierrot's Lunaire. And I have a small clip of it here, where you get kind of a sense of how it sounds with the vocal. So think about all the music we've listened to. What is this? Right? After listening to Beethoven, seeing operas, now we're here. And it's really different than what we had been seeing. So jazz. So the atonality that we are seeing in this music that is also coming out of the Soviet Union. In America, we have the Afro Caribbean improvisational styles with a range of European and African concepts and rhythm, new vocal styles called the blues, and a piano style called ragtime, which are the musical traditions of marching brass bands and the minstrel stage. Ragtime is a form of piano composition that is performing with syncopated rhythms, broken rhythms, and simple, appealing melodies. Let's take a look at Bessie Smith and what blues vocalization is like, and then let's hear some ragtime before we go back and get more into jazz.
My man's got a heart like a rocket.
So we are getting in her voice loneliness and despair. And again, that theme that we have been seeing from the beginning of the 20th century. This is Scott Joplin, and Joplin is the innovator of ragtime. You might recognize the song The Entertainer. So, jazz is going to take up then from the blues vocals, the loneliness and despair coming out of the voice, these harmonic patterns that we are seeing in ragtime, and they are going to put in syncopated rhythms, and a new kind of music is going to come out of New Orleans. Louis Armstrong is a jazz musician. That is a solo improviser. He can redirect harmony. He is also creating a new kind of singing called scat singing, that is an improvised set of nonsense syllables. We are also getting from great jazz musicians like Duke Ellington, we are getting concert hall jazz, a form of jazz that is really popular, that will be leading into the 1940s with bebop and other polyrhythms. And those polyrhythms, if you remember, when we were studying African rhythms in our chapter 9 in Encounter and Conflict, we were looking at African rhythms in terms of the polyrhythmic being the rhythmic version of what we saw happening in the church with the polyrhythmic voices, rising and falling at different places, different paces. So I want to show you a little bit of two different clips here. One of them is Louis Armstrong scatting to the song Hello, Dolly. So what we saw there at the end was not actual words, but simply rhythmic sounds that fit perfectly with the music. And then here is Duke Ellington, and you get an idea of the jazz band, and again, the marching band instruments that are being used in jazz.
Thank you.
And the last thing that we're going to look at in our chapter . So we had looked at what was happening in dance from Nijinsky. That was the afternoon of the faun in the last chapter. Russian dance is going to take a turn after following Nijinsky in his Rite of Spring, which has frenzied leaps, angular movements, frozen stillness. However, in 1917, he is going to go insane, and that will be the end of his influence on dance. In America, Catherine Dunham is known as the mother of black dance. She's a choreographer and a trained anthropologist. She is investigated in the resources of black heritage, from African-American slave dances to dance histories of Africa and the Caribbean, which we are going to look at ballet Creole here. So she is creating dance as a religious experience, as a metaphor for physical freedom in the late 19th century. And she is influenced by the 19th century from traveling minstrel shows like the high-stepping cakewalk and tap dance styles. And she is going to show us here in ballet Creole a kind of dance that has a religious kind of fervor to it. Okay, I can't play too much of this. Last time I posted this, I got censored on this. They didn't shut down the video, but they clearly let me know that this was a copyright infringement. Second thing that I want to share with you for our discussion this week, I wanted to get more into kind of what the Dada artists were doing and the absurdity around Dada. The Dada artists were making fun of serious art. They were making fun of anything that took itself too seriously during World War I. And that notion of the silly or the absurd is something that TV shows that I remember, like Monty Python, certainly engaged upon. So again, the Dadas are really... they are really pointing at a society that would allow this useless trench warfare to go on simply for the greed of exploiting their colonies. The Cabaret Voltaire, in its absurdity, is in strict opposition to what's going on in the war. But again, the brutality of the war also has this kind of compassion as well. And the silliness, I think, comes to a head in 1916 when the two sides get out of their trenches on Christmas Day after killing each other for several years. And they get drunk together in the no man's land between the trenches. And so the Germans and the French are getting drunk. They're exchanging Christmas gifts. They play a game of soccer. And then they get back in the trenches and kill each other again. That to me shows you what a useless war it was. I don't think you would see that between the Nazis and the French in World War II. I don't think you would see the Americans and the Japanese do something like that. So Dada is a protest art movement, anti-art, anti-middle class, anti-politicians, anti-good manners, anti-business as usual. Let's make collages that are striking, that are dissonant. And in a way, let's make new art in the process. Francis Picabia strikes me as a comedian in the Dada world, with the child carburetor here, this mechanical carburetor that is has these really silly diagrams that say sphere of the migraine, destroy the future, and the idea that the child is somehow a like a carburetor, a explosive mixture of air and food, or air and fuel. And certainly if you've ever changed the diaper of an infant and it pooped all over you, you know what that is. I talked about Duchamp in the lecture and what his ready-mades mean. I think the ready-made, the bicycle wheel, is probably creates my three favorite works of art by Duchamp. L-H-O-O-Q, The Fountain, and then The Bicycle Wheel, where he takes apart a bicycle and then drills a hole into a stool. The stool is no longer something you can sit on. The bicycle wheel is something you cannot use. He describes it as utterly useless. And I think that that's what makes it art, is that it's utterly useless. In Santa Monica, where Duchamp moves and plays chess, he has his first museum show in 1963. And we see him playing chess with a writer and Yves Babets. Yves Babets is kind of known as kind of the Kim Kardashian of her age, kind of hanging around celebrities. And her fame is kind of mixing with their fame. Here she is nude playing chess with Duchamp, and he seems to be completely unaffected that there is this beautiful nude woman across from him. He is interested only in the game. Salvador Dali, the surrealist artist, The Persistence of Memory, he also lives as kind of an absurd human being. He believes that he should be flamboyant and unconventional. He will talk in gibberish. He will wear outrageous clothing. Here he is walking an anteater in Paris, acting as if there's nothing unusual about walking an anteater in the middle of Paris. We get absurd theater coming from Samuel Beckett and his Waiting for Godot. Godot never appears. We never know who Godot is. And we get somewhat of this strange sense that while nothing is happening, our two characters, our two, I guess, homeless characters, are waiting in vain, and also we get a sense of their existentialism, the idea that they are purely products of existence and that there is no meaning to life whatsoever. From Antonin Artaud, who I talked about in our lecture of Madness, where we looked at his drawings made after electroshock therapy, we are seeing his theater of cruelty here. In his theater of cruelty, he wanted to return to magic and ritual as a new theatrical language of totem and gesture, devoid of dialogue that would appeal to the senses. A theater in which the violent physical images crush and hypnotize the sensibility of the spectator, seized by the theater as a whirlwind of higher forces. As I had mentioned earlier, Monty Python, and I have a clip here from Monty Python where Hitler has escaped the war and is living in a boarding house, and as he is questioned by the owner of the boarding house and also new potential people that live there, he seems as if his evil unconsciousness is bubbling up from him, and he clearly cannot keep a lid on who he really is, and it's kind of amazing. We're going to do an assignment, though, where we're going to take this idea of absurdity to something more recent, to vaporwave. So vaporwave is a form of music that emerges in the early 2010s. It is defined partly by slowed down chop sample of smooth jazz, elevator, R&B, and lounge music from the 1980s and 1990s. It is also a art style that has a strange kind of visual medium of 8-bit video game loops and also using like classical sculptures and things as images in videos or in its album covers. We're going to watch a documentary on it, and I want you to compare the documentary to Dada, and I'll show you that in a second. Vaporwave and what happens musically had a brief kind of filmic companion in 2020 with Racer Trash. So Racer Trash was a phenomenon that when Hollywood closed down during the pandemic in 2020, 60 editors got together and recut various films in ways that they were unwatchable as the original film, and then they would reboot them with slowed down vaporwave music and use lots of special effects. Racer Trash ultimately was hierarchy-less and will fall apart because of that. But there were about 600 of us in the world that every week tuned into Twitch, and it was streamed on Twitch to an incredulous audience. And here we're looking at the first of the films that they put together called Speed Vapor, based on the movie Speed Racer.
Why don't you tell me why I should keep driving?
That's for you to figure out.
X?
Racer X! Racer X!
Jesus, kid, you can drive.
Why don't you just tell me the truth? You're Rex, aren't you?
You mean your brother?
You first appeared 2 years after Rex died. You drive just...
Okay, so look at what's happening here with the completely digitized effects, the colors of white, pink, and blue that are the symbolic colors of characters that might be transgender. We have completely taken the original film apart, added in a slowed down soundtrack, and in my opinion, magic is happening here. Okay. My talking head back. So I want you to watch this documentary. It's about 15 minutes, and I want you to kind of figure out what vaporwave is, how does it work, give me examples that show me that you're watching it, how is vaporwaving using and commenting on commercial culture, what makes up the look of vaporwave, and why does vaporwave seem to have the sense of absurdity like the Dada movement? Make sure you give me examples of this video of a Dada musical performance, as well as examples from the film. And then I kind of share with you the idea of ridiculous music in a song from Captain Beefheart, Moonlight on Vermont, that the first time you listen to it, it is completely annoying, completely awful. And then about the fifth time I heard it, I began to like really get into like how kind of amazed I was at how hypnotic the music was. If you want to listen to that, that's certainly optional to you, but that just kind of shows how things that initially seem to be off-putting because they're new sometimes kind of seep into us, and then all of a sudden we can't do anything other than listen to them. All right, everybody. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.